Talking Mental Health on BCTV is sponsored by the County of Berks through the Berks County MHDD program in collaboration with the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center.
Hello. Welcome to Talking Mental Health. I'm Jim Miller. It's good to see you today and great to have the guests I have today. I've never had these two as a guest on the show. I have Adrian Grieve. He is newly minted as the Division Disaster State Relations Director, and I'll let him talk more about that. We also have Jennifer Graham. She is the brand new minted Executive Director of the Tri-County Chapter. So great to have both of you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jim.
Let's talk about, because you were the former executive director.
Correct.
As of just a few weeks ago. So tell us about your new role at the Red Cross.
Yeah, it's certainly a mouthful, Division Disaster State Relations Director. I'm still getting used to the title myself. So really, I cover the relationships with our state government, our state voluntary agencies, so working with Salvation Army, the Southern Baptists, everybody across the states, mm-hmm. For Pennsylvania, Maryland, District of Columbia, and Delaware. And also work with the federal government with our FEMA partners out of Philadelphia. So the new role involves quite a bit of travel back and forth to Maryland, Delaware, and obviously Philly with our FEMA friends. Mm-hmm. So new role, but I've done a lot of this before. Years ago, even just as part of the local chapter. So
Right. It's
a sort of old hat, new hat type of thing, but getting used to just not being the executive director anymore.
Right. How long total? How many years with the
This is my 30th year, actually.
Wow.
Started right here in Berks County. As a local volunteer, I did that for 3 years, and then the last 27 years, not always as the executive director, but always here in Berks County at the chapter. So it's definitely time to pass it on to somebody fresh to bring in new ideas and for me to just take on a different role.
And that brings us to you, Jennifer.
Yes.
You're the new executive director for the Tri-County chapter. Tell us about your history.
Sure.
With the Red Cross.
Yes, happy to. I'm very thankful to now be part of the Tri-County chapter, which is Chester, Berks, and Schuylkill counties as the executive director. I've worked with Adrian for the past week very intensely, and before that we had a lot of opportunity to connect.
So now you
together.
Know everything he knows, right?
I wish. He is a wealth of knowledge, and I'm certainly coming into an amazing chapter.
Yeah.
I've been with the Red Cross for 21 years. In a variety of different roles, but mostly within our biomedical line of business.
Okay.
And the last 5 or 6 years of my career have been mostly in Chester County, Pennsylvania, mm-hmm. Working with a team to sponsor blood drives at corporate, community, educational, and civic groups.
Okay.
As a team, we were responsible for bringing in 50,000 units of blood, which would bring help to over 150,000 hospital patients.
Right. When you say biomedical, you're talking mostly about blood donation.
That's correct. Right. Yes, thank you. Yes.
You made sure or tried to make sure that that goal was met and you had the blood that you needed.
Yes, the need for blood never takes a holiday.
Right.
Every 2 seconds, someone in the U.S. needs blood. So making sure that we're doing our job to keep the blood on the shelves was top priority. Mm.
Well, let's use this time to plug it, right? Plug it. How does someone go about becoming part of a blood donation?
There are countless opportunities every single day between mobile blood drive operations and mm-hmm. our donor centers all across eastern Pennsylvania. The best way to find a local blood drive is to call 1-800-RED-CROSS or go to redcrossblood.org. Simply give them your zip code and opportunities will be provided as to where you can donate.
Okay.
To find out about if you're eligible to donate, there is a wealth of information you can find when you call our 1-800 number. You can ask questions about places you may have traveled, medications you may take, the age requirements. It's a minimum age of 16 in Pennsylvania with parental consent. And also on our website, redcrossblood.org, there is a lot of information about tips before you donate blood, mm-hmm. frequently asked questions, the donation process.
Right. So if you're on the phone, it's 1-800-RED-CROSS.
Yes.
And then there's also ways to find out online.
Yes, redcrossblood.org.
Okay. like you said, there's always a need.
Yes, there is.
Right?
Every day.
Okay. Other than blood donations, and I guess that's one of the things Red Cross is known for, the other thing they're known for, of course, is the Red Cross is there in time of disaster, right?
Yes.
That's what you think about, and that's what we hear about. What do we need to be prepared for locally? You know, you're in this Tri-County chapter.
Yes.
What do people need to be prepared for?
Almost anything. There's very few things that may not happen. Okay. I guess a volcano eruption is one of the few. We've had tornadoes. We get the severe winds and the rains from hurricanes, tropical storms. But what we deal with, I would say 98% of the time, locally, are home fires, affecting single-family homes or multiple units, large apartment fires. That's the biggest thing. So that's definitely what I think most of the areas of the country, that's really the largest threat is the home fire.
Okay. My son lives in Hollywood, and he talks about earthquake kits.
Yep.
What can people do locally prepare for? You don't know which disaster it's going to be, but is there a way that on your website or you can tell people how we can be prepared for a disaster, which we don't know what it is, but what do you tell people?
Absolutely. Certainly go onto the website, redcross.org. There's a whole section on preparedness there.
Okay.
But they can put a general preparedness kit together, and that's your basic items, whether it be some water. It's basically a gallon of water per person per day that you want to have. So several gallons of water. You want to make sure that your medications are close at hand, so you can just take them with you. Anything that you would, as a family, really need if you were told in the middle of the night, you've got to leave the house and you have to leave now. You know, in a fire, you have usually a max of 2 minutes to get out of the house.
Right.
And so you don't have time to be thinking about where things are. And quite honestly, as much as we talk about preparedness kits, a lot of folks don't put them together all the time, but at least have things close at hand. Have a bag with a few extra bits and pieces, a change of clothes in it, and your medications close at hand. Know where your important papers are and that sort of thing that you would need, phone numbers for your insurance company and all of the basic things like that, that you literally can grab and leave. And of course, if it is a fire, you just want to get out of the house, period. You don't want to be wasting time grabbing anything. You really do need to get out of the house the second that the smoke alarm goes off.
Okay. Since that's probably the most common disaster in Berks County, what are the range of services you provide for people who've had fires?
Great question. We do a lot of different services. Primarily, I think most of the time, it's really meeting with the families, assessing their individual needs. Do they have family they could stay with tonight? And if not, we can provide lodging or provide assistance for lodging. Were they able to get some clothes out of the house after the fire was extinguished? If not, again, we can provide some assistance so they can get a basic change of clothing. Same with food. So it really depends on what the needs of that family are. But I think the one thing every single family needs, regardless of whether they need clothing, replacement medication, is just that support, that emotional support to get through, whether it be the next 2 hours or the next 20 days or 2 years.
I mean, people are very raw emotionally at that moment.
Yes.
And so your people, your staff and your volunteers have to be cognizant of that and know how to work with people who are at a really bad place emotionally.
Definitely. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's very much needed.
Oh, yes.
That's,
yes.
You know,
yes, definitely. We do a psychological first aid training for all of our folks so that we know how to deal with the basics. But we do have mental health volunteers who are trained if we need to do additional support for the families.
I know in my clinical practice right now, I even have two people that are experiencing post-traumatic stress symptoms from recent fires.
Mm-hmm.
One of them had been even burned.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's not just the night of the fire.
Absolutely.
No.
It can be long lasting.
Yeah.
I want to remind our viewers that you can call us at 610-378-0426 if you have comments or questions for my guests. Again, the guests are Adrian Grieve and also Jennifer Graham, both of the Red Cross. You were going to say, did I interrupt you?
No, I was just going to talk a little bit about the mental health piece. You said
yes.
About the post-traumatic stress.
Right.
And I think people tend to think of, you know, unfortunately, that with war situations or
right.
It seems very tied to folks having been in the military and overseas, particularly in war efforts. But you're right, folks who have just been through something in their lives that is very traumatic are exhibiting the same symptoms. They're still mm-hmm. struggling with it, whether it be a loss of a home or, you know, God forbid, the loss of a loved one, which
right.
unfortunately we see too many times as well. So, you know, it's just something for folks to think of. You know, you have a neighbor up the street who has a fire.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're going to need that extra support, that extra comfort. So be there for them. You don't need to have the professional training just to be a good neighbor, to be a good friend, to support that person. Because a fire is traumatic. You lose your sense of
right.
of every normality, your mm-hmm. home, your clothes. You can't just go and get a shower. You can't. Mm-hmm. It's mm-hmm. very, very different.
You know, often people get out with their lives,
yes.
and that's about it.
Yeah.
You know.
Yes.
I guess this is where we come in and say, I'm sure you promote smoke alarms.
Yes. Yes.
And do you assist people with smoke alarms, or what do you just tell them to get them, or?
We have currently running right now our
okay.
Sound the Alarm campaign, where
okay.
the target nationally is to install 100,000 smoke alarms across the communities that we serve.
Mm-hmm.
We've had a couple here. A few weeks ago, we had one in Spring Township. We had a Sound the Alarm event where we focused on education, developing an evacuation plan, and installing smoke alarms in Spring Township. We have several more coming up this weekend. We have one tomorrow in Phoenixville, as well as Bethlehem Township, and then one on the 18th in Tremont.
Yeah.
Really targeted efforts to make sure that we provide as much education and information as possible
mm-hmm.
and install smoke alarms. It's been I've been to one. I was one in Philadelphia last week. It was amazing. It was a great day. Really got to meet some really wonderful people, both volunteers that gave their time to help install these smoke alarms and these wonderful neighborhoods that let us into their homes and let us provide mm-hmm. some education and information and install alarms for their
yeah.
safety. Further information, I'll defer to Adrian, but it's an amazing campaign that has literally saved lives.
Okay.
Yeah, we're at close to 600 lives saved now from this program nationwide. And the number Jen just gave, the 100,000 is for a 2-week period.
Mm-hmm.
We've installed millions of alarms across the country. We continue to do this. This is year, I believe, 3 of a 5-year program.
Mm-hmm.
And so we just keep working on this in every community across the country. And there is,
mm-hmm.
it's, I think, important to say there's no charge for
yes.
these smoke alarms. There's no charge for any of our disaster programs whatsoever, whether
point.
We are providing assistance or, in this case, proactively putting in smoke alarms. So
right.
folks, sometimes we'll knock on a door and somebody will be waiting for the catch, and there is no catch,
no.
Completely free of charge.
Well, I imagine the people, there's some people who can't even replace their own batteries in
yeah.
smoke alarms.
Yes, and these are 10-year lithium battery smoke alarms,
right.
which gives them peace of mind for that time frame.
Right, but in 10 years you need to replace it.
Of course, yes,
yeah.
yes.
Okay. What other kind of services, what other kind of disasters, I guess, do you offer mental health support? We obviously, after fires, what about traffic accidents?
Generally not with that sort
okay.
of thing. We,
okay.
You know, folks, I think typically we don't look, although it's tragic, we don't look on that as a disaster. It's not a
okay.
natural disaster.
Okay.
But we do respond to other natural disasters as well. Certainly mass casualty, mass fatality events. So, and sadly, the school shootings and shootings in malls and just in the community are becoming more and more common these days. And the Red Cross has a very important role in that, in setting up a family assistance center so that we can provide a place for families to gather. We can provide a place for all of the agencies to come together to, A, provide services to the families, but also for the agencies themselves, if you're looking at our federal partners, perhaps, or our local law enforcement, to be able to talk to those involved. And obviously, they're looking at it from the witness perspective, et cetera. So they're trying to solve the crime and ensure our safety. But we're there to help support the families and provide the, again, mental health and spiritual care, too. We we do have spiritual care volunteers as well.
Yeah, tell me about that.
Local clergy, folks who are chaplains primarily, who have really just become Red Cross volunteers. They just want to be able to go out to this sort of situation and provide comfort to the family. We're not pushing any religion, and we have folks from all religious backgrounds who have become volunteers with the Red Cross. So if somebody says, like, I really want somebody within the Catholic faith, or I really want somebody who is a Muslim imam, we can coordinate with those folks and usually help provide somebody to give them that support if that's what they would like.
This goes back, but I remember hearing something about that you had a special course for mental health providers who wanted to be disaster or mental health disaster counselors. Yes. What does that involve?
We're still doing that. It's basically, it's not obviously teaching folks mental health. It's teaching mental health professionals what we do in Red Cross.
And
so we are bringing existing mental health professionals in. The one thing I think is important to say, we are not taking the place of any existing mental health systems. So I saw Berks County MHDD, for example, is one of the supporters of the program. We have a great partnership with Dr. Mahalik and the team there. Same with Berkshire Psychiatric. We work closely with Dr. Ring and all of the staff there who were coincidentally supported our Heroes Breakfast yesterday. But we work very closely with existing mental health providers. So our volunteers come from maybe Berkshire Psychiatric or from the county or from various other organizations. And it's really to provide that immediate support, the helping the family through tonight and the next day or two. If they feel that that family needs additional support, then we refer to local mental health system. We certainly don't try and take the place of that whatsoever. So those folks go through some mostly online training and then can become volunteers and go through our system of training and then get out on a disaster.
I think the Red Cross advantage is you can be on the ground in a really short period of time to wherever it is, right?
Absolutely.
You have a knack for that.
Yes. Yes, and, if we can get you down there. We're unfortunately tied to the same issues that anybody is. If the flights are grounded, we have a struggle getting folks there too. But other than that, we can get folks in there pretty quickly. And there's always the local Red Cross, and that's where everything starts. So. You'll always have the people there, and we try and get extra folks in there as quickly as possible.
Okay. Jennifer, let's talk about some of the other local programs of the Red Cross. Or you want me to give that to
Adrian? Adrian for right now.
I will. Come on, you've been there a week.
I know.
Yeah, come on. Day five, we should know everything.
Come on. I will say that this chapter is very rich with really amazing programs. Yeah. And I think one of my favorites, I know Adrian will talk too, is our Veterans Transportation Program.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I'd like to hear about that.
We love our veterans. Red Cross has been tied with the military and with the veterans for forever. It really was where the Red Cross came out of in this country years ago and internationally. So What we do is we work with the folks who are in the military and the families, and once they have retired from the military, we continue to work with them. We have a free transportation program that takes them from their home in Berks County. We pick mm-hmm. them up and take them to Lebanon VA Hospital 5 days a week. Again, absolutely no charge to the veterans themselves. And they can get the services they need, and then we bring them back home again. Yeah. So 5 days a week, we're running that mm-hmm. across the community.
I've had some patients who have taken advantage okay. of that program. Great. Yeah, great. That's really great.
Yeah.
What else is going on with the Red Cross these days?
Gosh, first aid and CPR is always going on.
Yes.
Okay, so you're obviously yes. still involved in certifying
yes,
people,
yes,
teaching and certifying.
That continues to be a need, I think always will, because mm-hmm. As human beings, you know, we always have injuries, we always have situations mm-hmm. where unfortunately somebody suffered a cardiac arrest, chokes on a piece of food in a restaurant, you name it. So we've I think, adapted well over the years. It used to be that you had to come in and sit in the classroom and listen to a full day of training. And mm-hmm. As we started to evolve with technology, you can now do most of the class online. Mm-hmm. You just sign up, you do it online, and you literally come in for an hour, mm-hmm. An hour and a half, and you show the instructor the skills that you've learned, so they can be sure you have proper hand placement mm-hmm. for the CPR, and that you're doing the abdominal thrusts, etc., mm-hmm. correctly for your choking and that sort of thing, and then you get issued your first aid or CPR card, depending what you're taking.
Right.
So yeah, that's on an ongoing basis. We'd encourage folks, you know, if you're watching this and you're interested mm-hmm. in taking a class, just reach out to us at the Red Cross. Mm-hmm. The easiest right now, because technology has really been a huge boon. The old days, you used to have to call us and try and figure out the closest class mm-hmm. and when the classes were being offered. You can literally go online now to redcross.org, plug in your zip codes, and it'll tell you where the closest classes are to you okay. within 5 miles, 10 miles, 25 miles. Just makes mm-hmm. it nice and easy for people.
Yeah. I was reminded by a friend that Red Cross is involved, and I knew this years ago, in training swimming instructors, et cetera. I don't remember much about that.
Yes.
So you do certify?
Yeah,
or
we
what?
Still do
yes.
that, yes.
Through our aquatics okay. program. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, very much. It's one of our, it falls under the same, it's now training services.
Training mm-hmm. services.
Because that's the first aid, the CPR training. Mm-hmm. We even do babysitting training. We train mm-hmm. folks to be babysitters.
Oh, yes. I think my granddaughter did that
yes,
one time.
Yeah, so
when she was young.
That gives a family peace of mind knowing they've been through the Red Cross training.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But yes, specifically the lifeguarding, and we do the swimming as well. So most of your pools in Berks County have probably, I would say, I don't know a percentage, but a large majority mm-hmm. have probably had their lifeguards trained at the Red Cross mm-hmm. Through us and the partners. We don't have a pool ourselves, but we'll provide the instructor trainer, and they will come out and they'll teach the lifeguards to be lifeguards, and mm-hmm. They will teach lifeguards then to become lifeguard instructors themselves, so they can teach additional mm-hmm. lifeguards, and that's how we just keep growing that program. So
yeah. Yeah, I talked to someone that had been involved with teaching lifeguards and swimming and things like that. She's been involved for years in it.
Yeah.
And I think I was probably, when I was a kid, I was probably involved in a program that was being, you know, trained by the Red Cross.
It's a very sustained program. It's great.
Yeah.
And that's the funny thing. We've touched so many folks, I think, across the country that people don't always think of having had a Red Cross service.
Right.
And then
good point.
You're suddenly right. thinking, well, no, I haven't, but oh yeah, I did take a babysitting class, or my son was trained as a lifeguard, or my daughter took, you know, a first aid and CPR class she needed for mm-hmm. something in school. So yeah, it's amazing just how many folks across right. the nation that we mm-hmm. Were involved with on a I would say more positive basis, but not in a tragic situation,
right.
in something that's less sad.
Yeah, I was thinking it must take a lot of volunteers to operate. So tell us a little bit about your how people volunteer and how you get the volunteers, and you probably keep some numbers on how many volunteers and how many volunteer hours, I suppose.
Oh yes, absolutely. Yeah. The opportunities within being a Red Cross volunteer are numerous, and I recently myself just called into the Red Cross to become a volunteer, and the opportunities, they really tailor it to fit to what you want to do, what you're comfortable doing. Mm-hmm. There are so many different lines of business and so many different things you can help, whether it's through biomedical, whether it's internal, external, through disaster, mm-hmm. health and safety, coming into the office. It really does try and streamline it to what each individual person likes
right,
and wants
great.
And fits into their schedule. Mm-hmm. We really try and make it as malleable as possible. The best way to find out about volunteer opportunities, again, is through our website, because it will list, you know, really mm-hmm. the cachet of opportunities that are out there, as well as who to contact for more information and questions.
Okay. Why don't you share your website and your phone number?
Sure. Our local phone number, right from our Tri-County chapter, is 410-375-4383.
I'm going to let you do that again.
610-375-4383.
Right.
And the website.
Yeah. The best thing is just to go onto redcross.org
and type in the zip code.
Yeah, type in the zip code. That will take you. That's the easiest way.
It's simple,
yeah.
Right?
It is.
And people don't have to add the Tri-County piece in the
right.
end or anything, or Eastern PA.
Well, you know, as a member of this community, I'm so glad that you're there. So glad
Thank
that
you.
You're there.
Thank
you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
And my guests have been Adrian Grieve and also Jennifer Graham. And Jennifer is the new executive director, and Adrian has a long title. Division Disaster State Relations Director. And, you know, your combined years of service to the, it's just incredible. Just the two of you.
Yeah,
we believe in the mission. That's what it comes down to.
And there's many more of you out there.
There is.
And that's really great. So this is Jim Miller, and for Talking Mental Health, I say goodbye till next time.
Talking Mental Health on BCTV is sponsored by the County of Berks through the Berks County MHDD program in collaboration with the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center.